Amen. Amen. Thank you, David and crew. All right. Sakura preached to us this morning, so we're just going to say amen and go home. What do you think, Greg? My name is Will Urschel. I'm one of the pastors here at Emmanuel Baptist. And glad to be with you this morning and open God's Word. On your chairs around you, there's a little note sheet. You can take some notes during the sermon. My wife mentioned to me, she says, can you put a little bit of blank spot on there so I can take some of my own notes. There's a little blank spot there. So if you get bored, if you need to put your shopping list down, you can do that too. Or you need to get your drafts for your fantasy team, you can work on that too. But anyways, it's yours. Just want to let you know that. If you had too many of you in the row, look around. There's some on the other chairs, and there's some more in the back if you need to grab some. Also, if you're new visiting with us, you'll see a lot of folks here in the church have these binders. And we're going through a study of the book of Romans in the New Testament. And guess what? Your little sheet has a three-hole punch, and you can stick it in the binder. So if you don't have one of these yet, we got a table there in the back. Please feel free at the end of service to grab one of these. And there's also some good material in there to help you work through the week to get ready for the next Sunday and read up. So next Sunday, we're going to be starting in Romans chapter 2, and you can have your own binder and start working on that as well, too. All right, go ahead and Steve, give me that next slide there if you could. So we've been talking about salvation up to this point, and that's a good thing. But you know, salvation sounds like a positive thing, but what we want to look at today is, well, who needs this salvation, right? Because we were talking about there's this great salvation out there, and you're probably thinking about some people in your life that definitely need to be saved. Yeah, that person needs to be saved. Maybe it's your neighbor, somebody in your family, some of you run into. But let's talk about who needs that salvation. So we're going to be in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 32. Go ahead and give me that next one, Steve. And this was the last, 2 weeks ago, Pastor Greg was talking about this verse, and it's one of our memory verses too, where it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes," right? But part of that question is well, who are those folks that need that salvation? Who is it? Give me that next slide. Anybody recognize this? Anybody live in the 70s? Some of you younger people, the 70s, doesn't it feel like ancient history? You say, well, are you talking about the 1970s or 1870s? Well, it doesn't matter. It's still ancient history. So how do we communicate with people today? Well, we get on social media, right? Yeah, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, whatever else, right? Some people even email these days still, too, right? But when I grew up, when I was in high school, we didn't have any of that because there was no internet, there were no cell phones, and it cost a lot of money even to make a phone call, okay, because they charged you by the minute. So the way you communicated with people was by billboards and little bumper stickers on your car and your T-shirts. That's how you communicated people. So in the 1970s, Campus Crusade, where's Steve Ruffner? Steve, this is your guys. Do you remember this? He's got it. Campus Crusade said, we're going to do this big campaign and tell everybody that they need salvation. And so what they did, and I grew up in Los Angeles, so in Los Angeles, you go on the freeways, there were these billboards all over on the freeways. As you're going, it says, I found it. You can find it too. And see the upper little corner there? We got these little buttons. My wife is smiling because she did this too. All of us at our church just got passed out these little buttons. We're all supposed to wear these little buttons and said, I found it. And the whole deal was to get people thinking about, what did you find? And maybe I could find it too, right? It was sort of an intro to get people's appetite whetted to hear about, wow, they could just say, well, what did you find? You say, well, I found Jesus, right? I'm going to share it with you. It's cool. And even had a phone number. Isn't that cool? Don't try it right now. It doesn't go anywhere. So, okay. So, but it was an interesting thing as all this stuff went out and people put these bumper stickers. They had I found a T-shirts and buttons and billboards and everything else. People really didn't care. Matter of fact, they kind of looked at it and they said, wow, let's have some fun with this. So give me the next slide. This is what started popping up. I never lost it. I smoked it. I gave it away. And those billboards started popping up all over the place, okay? And I went to a high school. There was 3,200 of us in my high school. And I remember getting up every morning and saying, well, I don't wear the stupid button. And I was so embarrassed to show up at the school with the button. And what we did was we found the other people with the buttons. We all got together in a little group. I found it people. And we didn't talk to anybody else because we were safe with each other with our little I found it buttons. Okay, so much for helping people. You know, part of the reason why people didn't care is they said, well, I don't know why I need it, right? I'm glad you found it, but, you know, I got my own stuff that's going on. So give me that next slide. So I want you to do one thing before we dive into this. I want you to think about, if you had to finish this phrase, God is what? What would go with that for you? So on your sheet, you got a little blank there. So God is, just fill it in. What's the first thing that comes to mind? God is what? Fill that in that slot. Or if you don't have something, just be thinking about what you'd say. All right. What'd you get? What? God is good. What else? Holy. Uh-huh. Keep going. Faithful. Almighty, yeah. Love, yeah. Did you say that too? Yes, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, and we could go on and on and on with those things. Those are the things that come to us about God's characteristics and personalities, right? Yeah. So give me that next slide. So here's an interesting one. Yeah, God is love. That's one of his attributes. But you know that God has wrath? Wow, there's a word we don't use very often. When's the last time anybody has used the word wrath? When's the last time you've heard that used in a sentence? Maybe towards you. I don't know. But that's a phrase we don't use very much, right? So here's an amazing thing as we go into this passage. And yes, God is love. That is one of his key characteristics. And God is holy, and he is faithful, and he is just. But God experiences wrath. And that's not his nature. But he experiences it when he engages with us. Oh. It's not normally how I think about God engaging with me, right? Give me that next slide, and let's talk about this. So there's a lot. If you go to Merriam-Webster, there's a formal definition of the word wrath, but I'm going to give you one in terms of what wrath is with God. God's wrath is his holy and his, oh, you're ready for this? Because God is love, and he is holy. So God's wrath is his holy and his loving response to our rebellion against him. Because when we give God the Heisman and start walking the other way, he says, that's wrong, right? Okay? You choosing to be the Lord of your own life and doing your own things is just evil. And so God says, I don't love that. That's not something that is good. I'm not going to pat you on the back and say, oh, what a good person you are. I'm so glad you found your own way, right? And you get to walk off and go do that. No. That brings a righteous indignation to God and an anger towards what we're doing. Yeah. So let's read. This is our first passage. This ain't Will. This is our first passage. You get a problem with this? Go talk to God. I'm sure he'll love to have that conversation. What does he say? He says, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Yeah. And did you get the phrase there? All the godlessness and wickedness of people, right? Not just some of the godlessness and wickedness, not just a portion of, or the ones I'm not doing. It's all the things that you did and have done through your whole life to tell God, I got a better plan, and I'm going to go do my thing, and I could care less about you. And God's response to that is not, oh, man, can't believe Greg and Ron, I got into it again, but that's okay. You know, they're a pretty good couple, right? No, it's wrath. It's wrath when you don't treat your wife as somebody who's God's daughter, and you're not respecting that, right? It's God's wrath towards you when you look at your friend who's got something you didn't get and you say, oh, man, they don't deserve that. I should have that. And his response isn't, yeah, you're right. No, no, his response is, it's wrath. Because that's not his nature. It's God's wrath when we say, I'm going to do it my way, right? Yeah. Give me that next slide. We spent a whole morning talking about God's wrath, but Greg gave me a whole bunch of other verses, so we're not going to do that. We're going to keep going. But I'm going to get one thing for us to think about. God's wrath is something that is fearful, okay? Now, people's wrath, you say, you can rant and rave, but I'm just going to leave you, and I'm going to go someplace else, and I get away from you. You cannot get away from God's wrath. There is no escape, because it is eternal, and there's nothing that you can do to take care of the hunger of that wrath. You can't appease that wrath on yourself. There's nothing you can do that can resolve it. So once God's wrath is turned on you, it will be there forever. Now listen to this from the prophet Nahum. He says, the Lord is a jealous and avenging God. I didn't hear the word jealous or avenging when we came up with our characteristics. It's who God says he is. The Lord takes vengeance and is filled with wrath. The Lord takes vengeance on his foes and vents his wrath against his enemies. The Lord is slow to anger, but great in power. The Lord will not leave the guilty unpunished. His ways in the whirlwind and the storm and the clouds and in the dust of his feet. He rebukes the sea and dries it up. He makes the rivers run dry. Bashan and Carmel wither and blossoms of Lebanon fade. The mountains quake before him, and the hills melt away. The earth trembles at his presence, and the world and all who live in it. Who is that? That's us. We're the all who live in it. Who can withstand his indignation? Who can endure his fierce anger? His wrath is poured out like fire, and the rocks are shattered before him. Now, this is not the image of what we hear in our praise songs and we think about as God. But this is God, okay? Yes, God is love and God is holy. And this is the holy, loving God's response to evil. And this is his response to us when we do evil. Now, you've heard people say, well, God hates sin, but he loves the sinner. No, God hates sin, and he hates the sinner who is sinning. And his wrath is towards sin, and it's towards the people who sin as well. And there's no differentiation there at all. Let's keep going. And some may say, well, I didn't know about what God required or who his stuff is, so don't blame me. Well, okay, don't argue with me. Argue with God, but this is what he says. He says, nobody gets to claim ignorance of God in any part of the world, anywhere, in all of creation, no one can say, I didn't know that there was a holy and righteous God. He said, well, how can that be? Not everybody's gotten a Bible or somebody's told them about them. You know, well, God says, I gave everybody a message. And he calls that message creation. As a matter of fact, I would encourage you to come Sunday night to hear from Dr. Whitaker, because he's going to tell you about things of the creation that reveal God that you don't get at Ohio State, and you're not going to get at Xenia High, and you're not going to get at a lot of the places that we go to get educated, or you're not going to get it on YouTube and stuff. But God said, the amazing thing is God said it's there, and part of what we're going to hear about tonight with John is how that actually is revealed to us, right? But listen to this. Listen to this. This is the next verse instead of Romans. It says, since what may be known about God is plain to them. Who's the them? Us. Everybody in this room. It's plain to us. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, right? That's the part that he's holy and I'm not. He's eternal and I'm not. have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. So nobody gets to say, I just didn't know. Because if you have lived in his creation, you knew. And tons of verses about this in the Bible. I'm just going to give the one I love the best is Psalm 19. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the works of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth and their words to the end of the world. Wow. Wow. Does anybody know what NASA stands for? National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Yes. Does anybody know what NASA's spending 85% of their budget on these days?
Looking for water.
Uh-huh.
Does that exist?
Yes.
And life on other planets.
Yes.
It doesn't exist.
They're looking for SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Right? Because they know it can't be us and the universe, because we're a mistake. We're an anomaly. We're just a little blip on an inconsequential solar system on a little, you know, galaxy on the edge of the universe, okay? And there's got to be so much more out there. So they're spending all their money on that. So I used to work for the Air Force, and I got a call from the chief scientist at NASA one day. He says, hey, we want to come help the Air Force because we're really good people and we can do that. And I said, hey, aren't you the guys that flew that, like, lander into the moon and it smashed into it because you messed up your numbers? And he said, yeah, that's us. I said, I don't know that we really want your help, but well, I said, tell me some more. And he said, well, we were doing all the SETI stuff, but we got a little bit of money over, so we thought we'd help the Air Force. And I said, well, how about you give us all of your money and give up this goofy SETI thing? And he goes, what do you mean? We need to go out and find it. And I said, no, why don't you tonight walk outside and look up at the stars? And the stars are telling you that there is intelligence out there. There's a creator. He's already told you that. He exists if you would just stop ignoring it. And then we can use all your money to actually help us. And, you know, he never called me back. I'm sorry. I tried. That was it. So that was one of my Air Force moments, Sarah, and she says, that's why you don't ever get to communicate with anybody else well. So, all right. So, yeah. So we're all have seen God's creation, and if you're blind, you can touch it, and if you can't hear it, you can taste it. We've all had, that's why God gave us these amazing senses to understand his creation, and we all know. Okay, well, I know. Well, what's the next thing? Let's keep going. Wow. We all knew, and we all had the same response. We all rejected. Everything that creation revealed to you about God, we all turned away from in our lives. And we worshiped the creation instead of the creator. And we chose foolishness over wisdom. Yeah. You say, well, that wasn't me. What are you talking about? I mean, I know a lot of foolish people. And I know a lot of people that are doing stupid things. It wasn't me. Well, you know, it's kind of interesting. We went through this whole COVID thing. You know, none of our kids everybody became a homeschooler. Isn't it amazing? All the bars in America closed and every family became homeschoolers. And it, you know, the church didn't have to do that. It just happened with the virus. It was amazing. So, but we had all our grandkids. I had four of our grandkids at home. And they weren't around other kids for like over a year. And while we had them at home, you know, Genevieve would come over and have Wyatt, and she'd just reap out and smack him in the back of the head, you know, and then she'd run off. And then, you know, what Wyatt would do, he'd start screaming and stuff, and then he'd find his sister Lorelai, and he'd smack her because Genevieve was too hard to catch, but he could smack Lorelai, right? And so, and Genevieve just sat there and screamed and everything else. And so, you know, we sit him down on the couch and say, what are you doing? I said, do you ever see, has Grandpa ever smacked Grandma in the back of the head? Said, well, not in front of you, I haven't. I do know that, right? Has Grandma ever smacked Grandpa on the back of the head? I said, has your mom or dad ever, I said, I'm trusting this didn't happen. Have you ever seen your mom or your dad smack each other in the back? Where did you kids learn this? I didn't have to teach them. It's amazing. It wasn't like, okay, 4 o'clock, we're going to go on how to smack your brother and sister in the back of the head. That's class at 4. It's 15 minutes long. That's all we need. No, I never had to teach them that. They knew how to do it themselves, and you did too when you were growing up. Because why? We rejected the Creator, and we chose foolishness, and we behaved foolishly. Yeah. Next set of verses here in Romans. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God. Although we knew God, we neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile. Or how about our thinking became futile? And their foolish hearts were darkened. How about our foolish hearts were darkened? And although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and animals and reptiles. Yeah. And that's us. We all did that. If you're just honest, you don't have to be honest with me. I'm not the one. I don't have wrath for you. You just need to be honest with your Creator. He's the one that's got the wrath. Be honest with him, right? Next slide. Wow. So, what's God's response to you telling him to take a hike? And are you just going and doing your own thing? Well, we don't have to guess. He actually tells us what that response is. You know what? Now, here's the interesting thing. In our mind, when somebody does wrong to us, what do? I'm going to fix it. I'm going to make sure you never do wrong again, right? I'm not going to let you hurt anybody else. You don't get to hurt me anymore. And you're going to be foolishness anywhere, right? You're going to get, so I'm going to put some boundaries around you so this doesn't happen anymore. That's not what God does. And a lot of times we figure that's what God, you know, we look at it and say, well, God is wrathful because of all the stupid things I've done. Then I get his wrath. No, no, no. God is wrathful because you rejected him. And in his wrath, he says, I'm going to let you be as foolish as your heart desires. I'm going to allow you to drink the dregs of foolishness to its max. Therefore, God gave them over. Did you get that? Gave them over. I'm going to let you go in sinful desires in their hearts. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the created things rather than the Creator, who is forever to be praised, although we were not doing that, right? Amen. And because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. When you told God, take a hike, God said, great, I'm going to give you over to all of your foolishness, and that is my wrath on you. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind so that they do what ought not be done. See, God's not wrathful and all of a sudden life goes bad. Oh, well, you know, God's angry at me, so, you know, so my car doesn't run and I can't pay my bills and my friends aren't nice and blah, blah, blah. No, no, God's wrath is I'm out there being a foolish person and all these things go terrible because I chose to do it. He's just letting me live that out. Let's keep going. So what does it look like in your life when God frees you to be foolish? Because he's done that to everybody in this room. At one point in your life, he freed you to be as foolish as you wanted to be. And could creatively think up ways to do that. It's tragedy, gang. And I want you to get this. It wasn't that we were doing tragic things and we got God's wrath. No, we rejected God and we got his wrath to follow foolish things. And then tragedy comes into our lives. Okay? The first tragic result he talks about is he says, I will turn you over to unbounded lust in your life. And for some people, it's way more creative than other people. And some people are introverts, and some people are extroverts, and some people are more daring, and some people aren't. So whatever your boundary was, you'll go to the extreme of it, because it's yours. That's where you go. And God said, in my provision for you, I gave you a place to have intimacy called marriage between a man and a woman. And he says, it is great there because that's how you build each other up and care for each other. And in God's wrath, he frees you to go have lust anywhere and everywhere. And lust has nothing to do with love, because love says, I want the best for the other person. The best for the other person is for them to not be under God's wrath, right? That's the absolute best for the other person. Lust says, you're going to fulfill my needs, whatever I decide those to be. That's what lust is. So listen to this. He says, God gave them over. Get that? Gave them over. That's the wrath of God. In sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity, for degrading of their bodies with one another, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Okay, that's where all that comes from. It's God's wrath on us, and he calls out in the midst of this. He says, There's a whole spectrum of lust, okay? We could spend a week talking about that too. And we may not even cover it all. But he says, I'm going to call out specifically one flavor of this. He says, that's the lust of men for men and for women for women. And what does he say? He says, even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. And in the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed in shameful acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their error. Now, in America, in October of 2022, this is what you're not hearing in our culture. Okay? Our culture says, no, that's actually freedom. And that's love. And that's a place we all need to be going if that's where we want to go. So don't argue with me. You go talk to the God of the universe that actually created you and had the best in mind for you with your relationships. And the reason this may be irritating you right now is because you've given him the Heisman and you say, I have a better plan. And you know what? He said in his wrath, he says, okay, you got a better plan. I'm going to let you go experience that other plan. Because that's my wrath on you. So get real with the creator of the universe. Don't argue with Greg. Don't argue with me. Don't argue with Steve. We're not your creator. You're not under my wrath. You're under his wrath. Talk with him. If you care, if you don't care, then he'll just give you more wrath. That's okay. But just be honest about what's going on. Let's keep going. Another tragedy, he says, in every relationship you have, I'm going to let you be as depraved as you can imagine. Anybody use that word depravity here this last word? Anybody seen it used? That's amazing. All these really cool terms, America seems to have forgotten them in our vocabulary. We don't use them anymore. Yeah. So what is depravity? Oh, well, good thing God tells us what depravity is, right? I don't have to go to Webster. He tells us right here. He says, they have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy. This is what depravity is. Envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. Depravity. They are gossips. Depravity? Just sharing a prayer request. What's going on here? I mean, that can't be depraved. Depravity, when you're sharing something with somebody to hurt somebody. God says you are depraved. And guess what? That depravity was my wrath on you because I'm letting you go there so that you get the tragedy of it. They are gossips. They are slanderers. When you talk about somebody, to tear down them in somebody else's eyes, that's depravity. They are God haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil, and they disobey their parents. Oh, where's all the kids in this room? Well, we're all kids in this room because we all got parents. Did you know disobeying your parents and giving your parents the Heisman is depravity too? Wow. And that ain't just when you're 10 years old giving your parents the Heisman. That may be when you're 40 years old giving your parents the Heisman. That's depravity. That's God's wrath on you. Okay, amen. Let's go home. Let's hope that's not the end of the story. But let's keep talking about it. Next slide. So this is the end result of what this looks like over time. Okay? God said he created us in his image, right? We're the image bearers of God. But God says, as I turn you over in my wrath to lust and depravity, you stop being my image bearer. Okay? Because the image isn't the physical body, right? The image is God is love. God is mercy. God is faithful. God is understanding of things. And we stop being those things. He says we become, there's no love in us. There's no mercy. There's no understanding. And there's no faithfulness. And these things no longer reflect the creator of the universe at all. And God in his wrath has allowed us to pursue things that remove all of his image from us. And we're no reflection of him anymore. And you know what? He says, I'm going to let you do this. And we do it even though we know the terrible consequences of that sin. Because we are doing this in rebellion to the creator of the universe who says, my wrath is unending and it will stay on you for all of eternity. And it will never be remitted. Nothing you can do can ever remit, take away my wrath. And yet, there's no shame. And we pursue it as hard as we can. Where's Pastor Van? Is he here today? He's gone. Oh, okay, well, that's right. Well, Pastor Van has never heard of the Lord of the Rings. What? What? Does he live in America? Okay. He actually got a cell. He has a cell phone now, right? Yep. He doesn't carry it with him, but he has one that he keeps at home. That's good. So, who's on the right side? Who's the pictures up here? Smeagol. That's right. And what was Smeagol Gollum looking for all the time? Was his what? My precious. My precious, right? Yeah. The reason I knew Van didn't know anything about Lord of the Rings was I talked about that the Dark Riders come to the Shire, and he just, well, who's the Shire and who's the Dark Riders? I don't know anything about that. All right. So, okay. Well, I think 80% of you got it. Maybe some of the rest of you don't, but what was Smeagol pursuing? He was pursuing this ring that was destroying him with its power. And it peeled away all of who he used to be, and all it left him with was lust for the power. And everything else he used to be wasn't there anymore. And yet, if he was honest with himself, he'd see it was destroying him, and yet he couldn't do anything but pursue it. And he would destroy anything else to have that. So, Tolkien spent a lot of time with C.S. Lewis, and there's a lot of imagery in Tolkien's writings about the wrath of God and the consequences of being turned over to that wrath. So even though we know the terrible results in our lives, we continue to pursue it, and we become less and less and less of an image bearer of God. Wow. Let's keep going. And in the midst of this, it isn't enough that we're destroying ourselves and building up eternal wrath of the creator of the universe, but we're looking for other people to encourage to do it as well. What is Satan, who is under God's wrath? Remember Satan? The archangel who led the worship of the angelic host before the Lord Most High. And when he said, I will be as God, I would have everyone worship me. Right? That's the imagery we were given. And it wasn't enough for him to be under God's wrath. When he saw God's creation of us, he did what? He held out the apple to Adam and Eve and said, you need to participate in this too. Well, we are image bearers of our Father. And remember who Satan said was our Father. He says, you are the image bearer of your Father, and your Father is Satan. So remember what we read in the book of Ephesians? He says, when we're under God's wrath, we are part of the family of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, who is Satan. Because that's who we belong to. And because we have his image now. And that's whose image we're bearing now, not God's. And we do what that family does, which is evil, and encourage other people to be evil as well. So I just went and flipped through what he says. They not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. Yeah. So I just want to give you a little bit of a flavor from contemporary news from this last year of people who were approving of evil to all of us. Let's look at the first one. This is Nancy Pelosi, Speaker of the House, third in line, two heartbeats away from being our president. The fact that this is such an assault on women of color and women of lower income families is just sinful. In Nancy Pelosi's version of God, sin is not allowing you to destroy your baby. Okay? That is sinful. Okay? It's sinful. It's wrong that they should be able to say to women and think women should be doing with their lives and their bodies. Remember, we're no longer gods. This isn't God's stewardship of our bodies because it's us, right? Because we took control of it, right? We got it. And we should be able to do whatever we want to do. But it's sinful and it's unjust. Wow. So before the just Lord of the universe, who said in his wrath, I will allow you to go do this, and that is my wrath to you, that not doing that is injustice. Let's look at another example. Give me the next slide. There's a president, President Biden, who actually sits in the White House, who is the current heartbeat of the leader of our country. Pride is back in the White House. It stands for courage. The courage of all those in previous generations and today who proudly live their truth. Did you get it? It's not living God's truth. It's living your truth. We can all discover our own truth. And we all need to respect each other's truth because that's our truth, right? God says, when you abandon my truth, I give you my wrath to allow you to pursue whatever truth you create. And that actually is my wrath and my judgment on you. The courage of all those of previous generations and today who proudly live their truth. Above all, Pride Month stands for love. You know, being able to love yourself, love whomever you love, and love this country enough to make it more fair and freer and more just. So I want to thank you and say happy Pride and may God bless you all. May God bless you all as you're under his wrath and running away from him as hard as you can. And I'm sure God will bless you in this. And you know what? The creator of the universe says, no, I'm not going to bless you. I'm just going to pour my wrath out on you. And my wrath is letting you be as foolish as you want to be. Let's keep going. Anybody ever heard of the Russian Orthodox Church? We don't have a component of that church here, but there is one in Dayton. There's a portion of that church in Dayton, but it's mostly in the nation of the Russian Federation. And they have a patriarch who's like their pope, sits over that church to guide the church in what? Well, supposedly in holiness and redemption in Christ, right? And this is what the patriarch of the Russian Orthodox Church said 2 weeks ago. He says, go bravely to fulfill your military duties, talking about going into the Ukraine. And remember that if you lay down your life for your country, you will be free with God and his kingdom and glory and eternal life. All your sins will be absolved if you go fight for our country. Wow. Wow. You don't need God to absolve your sins. You can do it yourself. Remember what I said, one of the characteristics of God's wrath is? It's terrible because it's eternal and it can't be appeased by us. And the leader of the church here says, I know a way you can appease God's wrath. You just need to go and kill these people and let them kill you, and God's wrath will be appeased. Wow, that's pretty cool. Remember what it said? Not only do foolish things ourselves, but we encourage other people to be foolish as well. I have some questions about what churches we would participate, you know, partner with in Xenia. I think if you came to Xenia, we're not partnering with him, okay, in the Easter egg hunt. That's not, because our God is not his God. I just want to let you know, we're pretty clear on that one, okay? We got that down. All right. Is everybody happy? We got really good happy thoughts going on right now. Well, sometimes you need some hard things so you can be happy. Let's keep going. We have this is on our refrigerator. It says, why do we do bad things? We do bad things because we are what? We're bad. It's pretty simple. It makes us happy to be bad, okay? That's why my grandkids are bad, because they are bad. They don't know Christ. They were born that way. That's their nature. I didn't have to give them a class to know how to lie. Didn't have, 3 o'clock's lying 101. 3:30 is envy. 4:15 is strife. We're going to take a break and have a lab in strife, and so we'll do a little bit of strife, you know. And then we'll have gluttony at 5 with dinner. I didn't have to, no, they knew it all. Because it was in their nature. And you know what? It's in your nature as well. Yeah. Let's keep going. Remember that question, who needs salvation? We need salvation because we're all in a desperate place with no way out, and it just continues to spiral out of control. I need salvation, and Pastor Greg needs salvation, and my wife needs salvation, and Melissa needs salvation, and Bill needs salvation, and the mayor needs salvation, and we all need salvation. And salvation is not us. Okay? So, before you can understand the good news of this powerful salvation, you got to understand the depravity and tragedy that we all were born into and were headed down as fast as we could move. And without the mercy of God, and you know what? God didn't owe anybody in this room salvation. Because if he owed it to us, that meant we earned it. And he has to pay us for it. No. Nobody here in this room earned God's mercy. We did earn his justice. Right? We did earn that against the holiness of God. Let's keep going here. So Romans is going to... We didn't get into it today. So I don't want to leave you with just this end of the story. Especially if you don't know God's provision for God's provision, not yours. I'm not going to give you this self-help 10-step program so that in 30 days you can be out from underneath God's wrath if you do these 15 things. It doesn't exist. It's not going to happen. God has a provision for this. So I'm going to give you just a little bit of a taste of that with some verses that many of us know. He says, for God so loved. Yes, God is love. But God is holy and just as well. The world, that's us, right? Put your name in there. This is you. God loved you so much that he gave his one and only son. He sacrificed his son for you, that when you believe in him, you won't perish eternally under his wrath. But you'll have what instead? Eternal life. Not just to say, I'm just going to punish you. I'm not going to have anything to do with you because I hate you so much. No, he says, I am going to bring you into my family. I'm going to absolve before my eyes all that evil and wicked, depraved things you did and all of your foolishness, all the lust and depravity and encouraging other people to be foolish. I'm going to cover all of that with the blood of my son. I'm going to do that, God said. And it was so evil and so wicked and so depraved, it required the ultimate sacrifice of God in his own son to do that. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. I condemn me. Christ didn't need to condemn me. I'd already done it myself by everything I'd done in my life. The Ten Commandments would never save anyone. The Ten Commandments are just a mirror to let me see how ugly I am. That's all it is. If you're not convinced, hold yourself up to it to see how lustful and depraved you are. That's all the Ten Commandments does. But we need that because if we don't understand that, we don't know why we have such a desperate need for salvation. Right? God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And here's the good news. Whoever believes in him is no longer condemned and is no longer under God's wrath. And God no longer tells you, go consume as much lust and depravity as you have. He says, no, come and be part of my family and live and reflect who I am. Have real love in your life. Have real joy in your life. Have real peace in your life because that's who I am. And as part of my family, you can have that too because when you were under my wrath, you were walking away from all that. But you know what? We tell people about John 3:16, but we don't tell them about John 3:17. And I want you to listen to this. But whoever does not believe on him, whoever does not take God's gift of taking care of his wrath, of appeasing his wrath, that thing that was so valuable, stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people loved what? Darkness. Instead of the light, because of their deeds were evil. Yeah. It's a fearful thing to be in the hands of a righteous, holy God. It is. Unless you're in his embrace, because the blood of Christ has absolved you of your sins and he calls you his son and daughter. And those are the hands that you want to be in, okay? You don't want to be in the other hands, okay? So here's some challenges for you, okay? I want to give you one challenge before we go on the other ones I want you to think about this week. I don't know where you are. Just because you come to this church doesn't mean you're not currently under God's wrath. Because coming to this church doesn't change anything. Okay? You may have a Bible with you. Great. You may have your Romans book with you. Great. You may have been here for 10 years or whatever. Your parents may not be under God's wrath. But I mean, you're not. You didn't inherit that from your parents, right? That's something you had to receive yourself, right? And God says, this is the gift of my son. I hold it out to you. And everybody in here needs to answer for themselves, have you taken that gift? And you know what? There's no, well, I'm sort of taking the gift. You ever get up a Christmas morning and your friend says, what'd you get for Christmas? Well, I sort of got this. What does that mean? Well, I'm in the process of getting that gift. Well, did you get it or didn't you? Well, you know, it takes a while to actually, you know, get the gift. So I'm working on it. Maybe by next Christmas I'll actually have it. No, you either got it or you didn't, right? That's how it goes. That's what a gift is. Take it or you don't. Be honest with yourself this morning whether you've gone to the creator of the universe and say, I know I'm under your wrath, and I know I put myself there because I rejected you. Don't tell me. You're not under my wrath. Tell him. And say, and I know this is a desperate place, and I can't get out of here on my own. And I want to. I want to be restored with you in a friendship. And I know there's only one name under heaven given to us by which that may be done. And that's the name of Christ Jesus and the sacrifice he did. And then if you want that, you need to say, God, please forgive me. I accept this gift. And I accept the covering of Christ's blood, which takes care of all of those terrible, tragic things I did. Okay? Or say, no, that's where I'm at, and I like it. I like being a fool. But just admit that that's what you're doing. God also says, today is the day of salvation, because you don't know where you're going to be tomorrow. You know where you are exactly right now, but you don't know whether you're going to be alive tomorrow. We had a family in our town that had one of their sisters that 3 weeks ago found out, 41 years old, healthy, doing great, and found out she had terminal heart failure and terminal cancer, and she passed away yesterday. Okay, that was not on the day planner for the month. But God knew. And God says, do not put off salvation, because you don't know where you're going to be tomorrow. And if you die without having accepted that gift, then you are under his eternal wrath for the rest of all of time. And that is not where you want to be. Okay? So feel free to come talk to any of us pastors afterwards. Talk to your friends that know Christ and have done this. Talk to your parents. But take care of this. Don't put it off. And a young lady called our church Wednesday and said, I got a debt. It needs to be paid. I said, great. Debt for God. Let's go take care of it. She said, no, I got $30 owed DPNL. We're going to shut my power off. Okay. So we didn't say, well, you know, there's people over at Ledbetter. They sort of help with that kind of thing. So go over there. And we said, why don't you come in and let's talk about it. So we set up an appointment. And she showed up on Thursday at 11 o'clock. And man, let me tell you, I was over at Bridges of Hope from 10 to 11, 15. Got sucked up with the shelter. And I had all our pastors were meeting in town. I was supposed to talk to them at noon. I had this little 45 minutes here. And I said, okay, I'm going to talk to you. So we talked about her debt and how she got into it. And I said, oh, I think we can help you out with your $30. But I said, you know, that's not your real problem. She goes, do I owe on my gas too? No, that's not your real problem either. You may, you just haven't talked about it yet. But I said, you know, your real problem is the creator of the universe is looking at you and you are under his wrath because you have a debt that you can't pay to him. Do you know about that debt? You walked into our church and you thought your problem was the $30. And your real problem was this debt you owed to the creator of the universe that you have no way to pay. And you know, nobody had ever told her she knew of God. She knew of Christ. She'd heard about him. I asked her, how are you and God doing? Oh, we're doing pretty good. You know, we talk every now and then. You know, it must be pretty good. She didn't know anything about the debt. And we talked about that. You know what she said? I need to take care of that debt. Because she became aware of it. She says, wow, I need to take care of that. And I said, well, we can do that right now. And so I was late for my pastor's meeting. But when I walked in there at 12:30, I had to say, hey, there's a gal that no longer has a debt to her creator, right? She is free of that debt for all of eternity. And now she has a creator that is embracing her as part of his family and calling her holy and righteous in his sight. Says, as far as the east is from the west, so I have separated your sins from me. He says, there's nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ. There's no powers, there's no principalities, there's no fears or doubts, there's nothing in the past and in the future that can ever separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Never. Okay? So you need to be honest with yourself. Do you want that kind of relationship with the God of the universe? And if you don't have it, I would challenge you, you need to take care of it today. And it's just like going down Christmas, getting underneath the tree, you pick up that package and you take it. That's it. Because it's a gift for you with your name on it. Give me that last slide. Well, here's some things I want you to think about. For yourself, maybe talk about your groups this week. How does God's wrath towards sin help you look at Christ's sacrifice for you? Remember last week we had communion. Communion, we do the first of the month. Sometimes it gets to be, it's just, some churches do it every week. And it gets to be this routine thing. We just do communion, right? Communion is to help us remember the cost that God had to pay to absolve his wrath on us. Do we remember that? What about ongoing sin in your life? What about when you continue to do foolish things? Because even though we're part of God's family, we grew up not being, and we know how to be foolish. And God says, I'm calling you to be like me, be my image bearer. But a lot of times we still give him the Heisman and go do foolish things. If you know that God has wrath towards that, how do you feel about it? You feel it's okay? What about in your friends that are doing foolish things? You okay with that? What about those who don't know God and have that terrible debt? Does it bother you? Is it a problem? If you saw somebody headed towards a bridge with the span gone, like the Kirill Bridge over there in the Ukraine that just happened yesterday, okay? They're going 60 miles an hour, and you're on the side of the road. Because, let's just stand here and watch this because it's going to be kind of interesting when they hit the span when it's gone, right? No, you'd probably be running after them and honking your horn and doing everything. You are headed towards tragedy. Stop! Well, there are people all around your life that are headed toward an eternal wrath of God. Does it bother you? That's where they're going? We know because we're part of his family now. They don't. How do we love them? Let me pray for us. Let's get the worship team back up here. God, we belittle your holiness and we belittle your majesty. And we make excuses for sin. And we justify why it's okay. And maybe it's not okay ongoing, but it's okay in that situation. And it is never okay. And it is never without a cost. Because every one of those foolish things I did was a nail in the cross of Christ. Because he had to pay that price for every single foolish thing that I have done or will do. God, help us to have the weightiness of sin and the weightiness of the wrath of a holy God and the wonder of a God of mercy that while we were running as hard as we could away from him, would pay such a tremendous price to bring us back in and clean us up and make us part of his family. God, help us to never lose that wonder, Father. Praise things in Jesus' name. Amen.